Well, good morning. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see you in the Lord's house today. Thank you so much for coming out and being a part of our service today. We are going to start our Easter Good Friday service with a couple of Nathan and Emily's kids. They're only two kids, actually, but unless there's something else I need to know. No. All right. They're gonna do a little thing for you. All right.
I don't know. I'm gonna have to do the motions. Hold on. No, don't touch it. Harley, stand up.
Can I sit between you?
I don't want to.
Okay.
Get your God signs out. God, he sent the Son. His name was Jesus. He walked on the earth, came to save us from sins. Let us sin, bad thoughts, bad words, I've been tied to break Richard's law and make him sad. But Jesus made the angry people, put on a cross, and he died. My family and family put him in a tomb, on the fourth day he rose. And that makes us happy and say yahoo. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't know how to follow that up, but we're going to try. All right, you guys come on up. We'll sing together. Thank you so much again for being a part of our Good Friday service. Stand with me. Let's sing a couple of songs together this evening. There's power in the blood. Somebody's hand before you sit down and just welcome them to our services tonight. You may be seated. You can sit down. Normally, on a special service, you wouldn't try to do a song that's brand new to the congregation. But we're going to try a brand new song because as we've been practicing this song for about the last month, and it may not show that here in a minute, but we've been practicing it that long, I promise. But it's just one of those songs, and it goes through the whole story. In fact, let me just read you this verse. It starts out with, and you can, and by the way, when we learn the song together, just with the words that you know, the, as you begin to sense the tune, sing it along. If you want to listen to it, that's fine the first time. But we're gonna, this is just one of those songs. It's called Oh Praise the Name. It says, the first verse is, I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Verse 2, his body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still all alone. Then the chorus starts off, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days, we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. And then what we're going to be celebrating Sunday is this next verse. He says, and on the third at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. There's one other verse, and there's a couple more choruses, but just sing with us. If you want to listen, I understand. I just felt like this was the song we needed to do tonight. Here we go.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body
sing your praise, O Lord.
Let's sing another more familiar song to you. Let's sing Amazing Grace together. My chains are gone. One more song before Steve comes, and just another one of those songs that just tells the whole story of just how deep our Father loved us, how much He loved us and cared for us, how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond any measure.
For the chosen one.
wounds death made my ransom.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you tonight just wanting to thank you so much for what you've done for us, the fact that you sent your Son Jesus Christ to this world to be born as a babe, but to die on the cross, the ultimate sacrifice for each and every one of us. And Lord, I pray that we would just not take that lightly, that we would consider as best to our limited knowledge and infinite wisdom, just the understanding of what all that meant. Thank you for a way of salvation. Thank you for all that you have done for us ever since that day. We love you. We praise you. Thank you for Steve. Bring back to his mind the words that you have for us tonight. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Great to see you guys this evening. And I want to start off with some instructions related to the Lord's Supper. We practice open communion here. And what that means is we don't have a right to deny you to the Lord's table. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you have as much a right to be here as anybody else. And so we practice open communion. The requirement is that you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the requirement for partaking of the Lord's Supper. And so I'm going to start off in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, go through this and just give a few quick instructions. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So when you come forward to partake of the Lord's Supper, you're making a public confession of your faith. You're proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. You're saying, "I am a believer in Jesus Christ. I have, by the shed blood of Jesus, I have the forgiveness of sins, and I have eternal life." That's the proclamation that you make when you come up here, and we do this all to remember him for what he did. Now, a few more little instructions. "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason," listen to this, "many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep." So what he's saying, what was going on in the church at Corinth is they were making a mockery of this. This is supposed to be done in remembrance and reverence to the Lord Jesus Christ for what he did for us. And some of them were making a mockery of it. And some of them were suffering serious consequences. So I challenge each and every one of us today, come up here with the right attitude to your Lord Jesus Christ, being thankful for what he did, understanding that by his shed blood, we have the forgiveness of sins. Now, a few more instructions. There are waste baskets up here. The ushers will be allowing you to come forward, and you'll stand up here at the front. When you get up here, they'll be passing out the bread to you. Wait until you hear me. I'll give you some words, and then everybody will eat at the same time. Then you exit down the center row. Then the same thing with the cup. We'll come forward. No, we'll do it all at the same time. Man, I should have really thought this through before I got up here, you know? Yes, and then we'll do the cup, and then you'll exit down, and there's waste basket to throw them down. Some of you are thinking, we had to go up there twice? So, all right, you guys keep me in line, all right? All right, now we are going to be in a scripture in just a few minutes in John chapter 9, starting in verse 28. So if you want to go ahead and find that. Now, what I'm doing, I'm looking at, in particular, some of the last words of Christ on the cross. And I tell you, I am, again, amazed. And a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the amazing Christ and how incredible the Christ was. And I'm considering these statements that he made from the cross in the middle of incredible suffering. Now, I don't know about you. Sometimes when I'm hurting a little bit or I'm distracted, I have a hard time focusing. But Christ on the cross in the middle of incredible suffering, he was suffering physically. He was suffering mentally. He was suffering spiritually also. But yet we see such wisdom, such clarity of thought, such love and forgiveness being talked about from Jesus Christ on the cross. All the while, mockers, people were, his enemies were on the ground mocking him. saying foul things about him. You know, you saved others. Why can't you save yourself? Come down from that cross and we'll believe you. When his entire mission is to go to the cross and to stay on the cross. Why? Because of his love for you and me. So now, one thing Jesus said that I think is often overlooked is Jesus said, "It is finished." Well, now in English, that is three words, but what Jesus actually said was tetelestai, which is one word. It means basically the same thing, but again, there's a lot more depth in what he said. And in fact, I want to go ahead and tell you, I think there was no wiser one-word statement ever said on the face of the earth than what Jesus said, tetelestai. This is not Jesus saying, "I am finished, I am done for." It is not him even saying, "It is over." This was a statement of victory. It was a statement of completion. The way tetelestai was used in during that time, the Greek was used, it was the mission was finished. Or perhaps it was a great artist, and the great artist would finish it. He'd finish all the touch-up, and then he'd stand back and say, "Tetelestai, it's finished. It's perfect. It's done." Well, it also had another meaning. If you were in debt during that time and you came and made a payment and got it all paid off, then if they had a stamp or whatever they had, maybe they had a stamp of some type, but they would write on there tetelestai, which means paid in full. Now think of how that applies. Now you have the Christ on the cross just before his last breath that he's going to breathe, and he says tetelestai. He says paid in full. He says it is finished, it's accomplished. And what he's saying here has a lot more depth than what we're thinking about. You know, Jesus was not on just a short mission like the Passion Week coming into Jerusalem. We know that he set his face like flint towards Jerusalem. He was determined to go. He told everybody, not everybody, he told the apostles that he was going to come into Jerusalem, die on the third day, be raised again. That was his mission. He made it very clear what he was going to do. So this in no way was a failure on the cross. This was completing the mission. It was tetelestai. Absolutely. It was a victory. So now this wasn't just a week-long goal or project that the Lord Jesus Christ had. It wasn't even a 3-year project, the time of his ministry. It wasn't even a 30-something year project, the time of his life. Now in John chapter 19, starting in verse 28, I want to point out a verse here and what it says. After this, look at this. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things had already been accomplished to fulfill the scripture. Now think of that. So here he is on the cross, and he's thinking about, have I done everything I was supposed to do? Have I accomplished everything? Have I fulfilled the Old Testament? Have I fulfilled all the requirements of the law? Have I fulfilled the mission that my Father gave me? And he says, tetelestai. But see, it even goes further back than that. Remember, Jesus Christ, he appeared many times in the Old Testament. I mean, think of that. So now it almost seems like here in my mind that Jesus' life is kind of flashing before his eyes. You know, has that ever happened to you if you were in a point where you thought you were going to die or something scary happened and it just seems like your life flashes in front of your eyes? He's considering all these things. Have I fulfilled it? Have I done all that I was asked to do? See, that goes way back. He appeared to Abraham and told him about the child of promise. It goes even further back than that. Who was it that walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the morning? God in human form is the Lord Jesus Christ. Who was it that sacrificed the animal to cover Adam and Eve's shame in the garden? It was the Lord Jesus Christ. So it keeps going back. But see, it doesn't even stop there. You see, because Jesus was there when Satan fell. Took a third of the angels with him. Jesus was there when the angels were created. Wait a minute, doesn't it even say that Jesus is the creator and sustainer of all things? So Jesus was there when the whole creation was just in the mind of God alone. And then now here he is on the cross. Here he is on the cross and looking back at all of this from the very beginning, looking back at all of it, and he says, tetelestai, it is finished. You know, I have to think about so many things, and we've studied them, like the Day of Atonement and how that was a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. And there, Jesus Christ was the angel in the burning bush. Jesus Christ was the angel in the pillar of fire. The Passover lamb was a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I thought, I wonder if the Lord, at this point in time, when Jesus is on the cross and he proclaims tetelestai, I just wonder if the Lord gave the glorified saints that are already in heaven, by this act that's taking place, if they gave them an opportunity to look down and see the Messiah on the cross and proclaim, it is finished, tetelestai. You know, thinking of the priests and who are already in heaven at this point in time, looking down, and they're sacrificing animals every single day and shedding blood of animals for the forgiveness of sins. The Day of Atonement every single year, over and over. What about the people in the wilderness who were there when the serpents were sent into the camp and they were getting bit by serpents? And God told Moses, I used to not understand this, God told Moses, put a bronze serpent on a stick, and anybody who looks at the serpent will be healed. Well, that's the cross also. Jesus even said, that's me. I am the bronze serpent. Well, why would Jesus make him out to be a serpent? Because he took your sins and my sins on himself on the cross. He became sin on that cross so that we could have total forgiveness. So I wonder if the people who were in that camp and they were looking at that bronze serpent, if they had an opportunity to look down at this point in time when Jesus was on the cross and he says, it is finished, tetelestai. You know, I wonder about the people who didn't have faith in God and who ended up in Hades during this, if God gave them an opportunity to look up at the one that they have pierced at this point in time when he was on the cross, when he proclaimed, it is finished. Don't really know, but this I do know. I'm certain that Satan was watching. You know, Satan, he didn't even believe that Jesus could accomplish the mission. If he did, why did he spend all that time trying to tempt him in the wilderness, 40 days? He tried to tempt him in every which way. And then he used Peter, and he'd use his own disciples sometimes to try to tempt him. And then in the garden, he's being tempted again. Satan thought that he even had a chance. But see, this moment, right up to this point in time, I have to think Satan is watching. I have to think Jesus is also being spiritually tormented, trying to get him to fail. And guys, honestly, I would have failed long before this point in time. But just being honest, I'm coming off that cross if I have the power to come off that cross. Maybe I could hang in there for a little bit. I don't know if I could even do that. Christ is amazing. He decided to stay on that cross and didn't come off that cross. And oh, how Satan and the tempter were trying to get him to come off that cross. I can imagine the rage that Satan felt when he said, tetelestai. Because Satan didn't have to read the book of Revelation, wasn't even written yet. But Satan already knew. See, now Satan would be cast out. Satan already knows what's going to happen. At this, before the book of Revelation was even written, he's already a roaring lion prowling about for whom he may devour, because his time is short and he knows it. You know, the word tetelestai also, and oftentimes the English language, it's not easy to translate. It really is not. Very difficult, because languages have different nuances. And this, I was reading about this week, this tetelestai that Jesus said, and the way that he said it was considered to be like a Greek perfect tense. Now, if you don't know what that is, that's fine, because I'm going to tell you what I read, because I didn't know until this week either. But the Greek perfect tense is basically saying it was finished, it is finished, and it will remain finished. That's what that really means. Past, present, and future. Now think of that. See, guys, what if we really look back at the Old Testament from the very creation at what God has done, everything has been building up to this moment. Everything. All of the Old Testament points to Christ. He's the creator and sustainer of all things. All of that, the sacrificial system, the law. He said, I fulfilled all these things. And I love here, see, I tell you, him just saying this one word, the waters are much deeper than I ever imagined. And sometimes the genius of things is when somebody can take something complex and make it simple. You know, when a person is trying to look smart, they take something simple and make it look complex. But the real genius is taking something complex and simplifying it. I'll give you another example of where he did that. It is the greatest commandment. They were trying to trick him. Which is the greatest command? Well, I mean, you can't pick one of the Ten Commandments. So what are you going to do? Well, Jesus simplifies all the law and the prophets in about 20 words. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and all your strength. And the second is much like it, love your neighbor as yourself. He said, all the law and the prophets are satisfied by those 20 words. Now think of that. That is absolute genius. Well, what he said here also, this one word, because I believe this point right here, this is when everybody knew he won. He had done it. He had finished it. He had accomplished what nobody thought could be accomplished. He had done the unthinkable, to live a perfect life and then sacrifice himself for the sins. He had achieved a victory over Satan, and I wonder how the angels marveled when it was revealed to them how the victory and the redemption of man would be achieved. You're going to do what? What? Surely not. You're going to come as a baby. You're going to live your life, and then you're going to allow men to kill you and crucify you? Surely not. Greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. See, guys, that is why, because that point in time, when everything's building up to that point in time, I believe that is like the fulcrum. That is the pinnacle of history at that point in time. Everything goes to the cross right there when Jesus said, it is finished. And guys, it doesn't stop there. Because remember, past, present, and future. And so right there at that point in time, ever since then, all of history built up to go to that point in time. And then after that point in time, everything goes through it yet again. Because past, present, and future, it is finished. Tetelestai. Now I want to turn with you to Revelation chapter 20. You ever thought about how, you know, there's this spiritual warfare going on, and here we have the victory already declared of what's going to happen, right? We know that Christ, well, why is that? How could that be? Well, up until that point in time when he says, Tetelestai, and then, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, and then he dies. He had completed the work. From that point in time, he won. He won the victory. From that point in time, the book of Revelation and all the other prophecies of the Old Testament were certain and laid in foundation. Now, God already knew what was going to happen, but at the same time, not everybody knew. Very few people knew. Satan wasn't even certain of that. He thought for sure that he could win a victory. So now, looking at Revelation 20, 7 through 10. When 1,000 years are completed, this is after the millennial kingdom. Now remember, during the millennial kingdom, Satan is chained into the abyss, and he's released for a short time at the end of the millennial kingdom, and where there's a slight rebellion again. But all of these things are already told what's going to happen. When 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison, will come out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for the war. The number of them is like the sand of the seashore. And they came up on the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from heaven and devoured them. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are also. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. It's not a question. It's a certainty. Because of the cross, because of Tetelestai, he finished it. He accomplished it, past, present, and future. Now, 21 verse 3, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. Now, who are those people? It's whoever goes to the cross. It's whoever looked to the cross. You see, everything before the cross built up to the cross and to that point in time to Telestai. And then everything since the cross is a result of the cross. See, we're living in the victory. That's an amazing thing about what Jesus did. So who are they? Well, I'm going to go to verse 20, verse 6 now, and we'll continue with this, kind of continue with this idea. I want to show you more of these things. Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Now, there are three parts to the first resurrection. When Christ was raised from the dead, there were first fruits raised with him there. The second part of the resurrection is the rapture of the church, which is what we are waiting for and hoping for. And the third part of the resurrection is the resurrection of Israel. Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, listen to this, the second death has no power. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Now, moving over to 20, verse 12 to 15. Okay, now this is the resurrection of the wicked dead. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne. This is the great white throne judgment. And the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And their dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. Now, I want to point something out to you. Every unbeliever gets a fair trial. They get a fair trial. But the problem is that we understand what the real problem is why Jesus came and sacrificed himself is because the standard is perfection. That's why Jesus is the only one that could do it. So that's why it's so important for us to tell people and invite people to hear the gospel, because no one can make it on their own. And it even says this right here. Look, there's two books. One is the book of life, and the other one is the book of deeds. So in order to prove someone guilty in this great white throne courtroom, they have to show that, all right, do they have sin on their account? Well, we know. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Jesus is the only one that lived a perfect sinless life. Okay, so all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, so they're going to have sin on their account. Then the next thing is their name written in the Lamb's book of life? Is their name there? Because if their name is there and not blotted out, if their name is there, then they have forgiveness of sins. But we'll continue. Look at what it says. The sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every one of them according to their deeds. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. Now pay close attention to verse 15. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. You understand what that means? Not a one of them made it on their own. Not one of them made it by being good enough. Not a single one. Now, you would think throughout all history, there's been some really good unbelievers out there. Well, again, the standard is absolute perfection. That's why Christ came and did it, because we, not one person since the fall, could achieve that type of perfection. Only the Lord Jesus Christ, the God-man himself. Now, I'm going to go to chapter 21. I may have wrote down the wrong scripture for this one. Chapter 21, 4 through 6. Okay, so now contrasting the two, you have a group of people that not a one of them made it, but they didn't have faith in God. They didn't believe in Jesus Christ. And that now you have a group of people that is the forgiven, the ones that he's going to dwell with forever. And look at verse 4. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm ready for that. You know, in this crazy world in which we live in, what I want you to consider today, because this world is falling apart, the craziness that is going on now. But guys, at the same time, look at what Christ did. On the cross, he said, Tetelestai. Look in the book of Revelation. It's already declared. This is going to be us. We win. And guys, with the same certainty that Satan knew when Christ said, Tetelestai, The same certainty that Satan knows right now that he is lost. That same certainty, we know we won because Christ won. We have the righteousness of Christ. There will no longer be any mourning, crying, or pain. The first things have passed away. And he who sits on the throne said, behold, listen to this, I am making all things new. See, he's not done creating. He's not done creating. What did he tell the disciples? I go to prepare a place for you that where I am, you may be also. He is a creating God, and he is still creating. I am making all things new. He said, listen to this, write, for these words are faithful and true. You can take it to the bank. Well, maybe that's a bad analogy today. I don't know. That used to be a good one. I got to change one of my sayings. And he said, write, for these words are faithful and true. Then he said to me, listen to this, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of the water of life without cost. Tetelestai. Guys, if you were in this room and you are an unbeliever, in a minute when we do the Lord's Supper, you know, or if you want to wait and you don't want to come forward and you want to talk to me afterward, I'd be glad to talk to you. But really, it comes down to just a matter of believing. See, believing isn't necessarily a matter of evidence presented before you. Believing is a matter of your choice. You make a choice to believe in God and to believe in the resurrection. So run to the foot of the cross. Look to the serpent on the stick. And by his shed blood, you will have the forgiveness of sins. Because in the end, there's only going to be two groups of people. There's only going to be two groups. And in one group, not one of them makes it by their own righteousness, and they didn't believe. And then the other group, who didn't depend on their own righteousness, had the righteousness of Christ applied to their account. So unbelievers, look to the cross. Believe in the Lord Jesus. Bow down to the Lord Jesus. Accept the free gift. Christ said on the cross, same word, paid in full. You know, if you come forward today, and maybe your salvation experience will be coming forward and partaking of the Lord's Supper with us today. If you do that, then the battle for your soul will be over. And you can say, Tetelestai, it is finished, past, present, and future. Now, believers, we have to live in the victory of Jesus Christ. We have to live like Jesus said on the cross, Tetelestai, it is finished, fulfilled, completed. You know, sometimes in this life it can be very frustrating. Maybe we can struggle with hope, but we have to remember it is finished. Christ won the victory. Tetelestai, we have to remember that. Maybe we're frustrated with the worldly conditions around us. It is finished. It is finished. Maybe we're living in fear. It's finished. Tetelestai, it's done. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. God, thank you. Thank you for the amazing Christ. Thank you that he was willing to pay it all, to give it all, to pay it in full. And then even thank you for his dying words on the cross, which were just stacked with so much forgiveness and love and mercy and clarity of thought and incredible wisdom. God, we pray today if there is an unbeliever in here, God, that they would just give their life to Jesus Christ. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But God, for all of the rest of us in here who are believers, God, help us to live in the victory and not in some undeclared defeat. God, help us to live in the victory and not be entangled by the cares and snares that go on in this crazy world. God, you said these things were going to take place. God, help us to not live in fear. Help us to go boldly before the throne, living a life. God, you've given us a choice. We have the choice to work within the framework of your will to do mighty deeds in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.